everyone, and welcome to Wrestling the Movies with me, Stevie Pearson, and
me, Elliot Redding.
And on today's episode, we are going to be reviewing a lovely little film called
Monsters Brawl.
Monsters Brawl. Monsters Brawl stars quite a few professional wrestlers, does it not?
Has quite a few in there. I think the most notable one is Kevin Nash.
Yeah, we got Big Nash in there, we got Kurgan in there, we got Rosemary in there. Jimmy fucking Hart is in there.
Who has a performance of a lifetime.
Yeah, he's loving this
like,
shit.
It's like, this is not just a paycheck for him, this is a passion project.
No, he is well away there, and he doesn't age, does he? He has looked the same since 1990.
Yeah, like a dye job and he's fine.
Yeah. But yeah, he has not aged at all. He's got some fucking creepy-ass Dorian Gray shit going on in his house.
Yeah, thank fuck that he wears glasses, though, because without them, his tiny little beady eyes, they're like a painting that follows you around the room.
Yeah. Anyway. Okay. I've got, there's an intro like a WWF pay-per-view.
Oh yeah, it goes full on. Like, yeah, it's got the movie voiceover artist and everything.
Yeah, yeah, the voice artist, of course, Lance Henriksen. Best known for Aliens.
Yes.
And he does a damn good job here too.
Yeah, again, doesn't phone it in. Must have got paid well.
No, that's, this isn't a bad film in terms of money. They've spent a fair bit.
Yeah, like, the special effect, well, not special effects, I should say, the real effects and, like, the monster makeup and stuff like that, they're convincing, they're all decent, like, and it's all shot on different locations. It's not like they've done it on a green screen. Like, you have promos for each combatant, each monster, and all that stuff, or creature, and they're all shot in different places. They went to a real swamp to shoot that. They found old castles for the vampire. They found, like, it looks like a creepy Chernobyl basement for Frankenstein. Like, they go all out for this.
Yeah, they set the whole film up like a, well, kind of like Lucha Underground, really, isn't it?
Lucha Underground, yeah, slash King of the Ring tournament.
Yeah, yeah, it takes place in a graveyard. So we have a ring set up in a graveyard. We have Jimmy Hart and two birds each side of him. Birds is a British slang word for ladies, I should state.
Two decent ones, like that.
Two decent. Oh. A couple of decent looking birds. A couple of lovers. You know, they're both there. You have that. Then you have the commentators.
I don't have the names of them.
Though one of them was really fucking good.
The main one that was like an old-timey commentator.
Yeah, the old-time commentator.
Yeah, the old-timey voice actor,
some people might remember from Porky's 1 and 2. He was lead star in that, if anyone's actually watched Porky's 1 and 2.
I've seen the first one.
Yeah, but he was lead star in that, and I think it's the first time I've seen him since Porky's 1 and 2.
Again, fucking sells it.
He doesn't have a fat woman pull his cock through a hole in the wall, you know, like in Porky's 2. But, he's actually really good. I can't tell if it's a complete Jim Ross knockoff, because he's got a cowboy hat and Stetson, he's blatantly a southerner. But,
yeah, first match I have down as Cyclops from Greece, and from Buzzard Bay, Massachusetts, we have... I actually can't remember who the fucking first one is, because I didn't write that bit down.
It was the witch, wasn't it?
Witch bitch, there we go.
Witch bitch.
Showing that... Monster Brawl, or whatever federation I guess they can class themselves under, don't have a problem with intergender matches, unlike most other people in the world right now.
We have Cyclops, who's a blacksmith, which with one eye I think is quite dangerous. One spark, and he's fucked.
Can't blink either.
No, there you go. You know, blink and you'll miss him.
And also the fucking midge. And also Witch Bitch has a manager.
Yeah.
Whose name is The Grub, who is a midget.
Yeah, and Witch Bitch, we should stress, is played by Rosemary from TNA.
Oh, Rosemary.
Oh, God, yes, Rosemary.
Rosemary.
Yeah.
She can keep the makeup on as well, it doesn't change the fact.
No. Though I thought she looked more like Miss Doyle from Father Ted, to be honest. She was actually a very nice looking lady outside of the Miss Doyle
gallery. Yeah, fair point.
But, Cyclops gives a little hype video where he delivers the line, "Honor is like an island." He has a whole promo about that. Then he has a match with Witch Bitch.
Considering Witch Bitch is played by a professional wrestler, wasn't many moves in this one as there are in other matches.
No, it was more just a slugfest.
Yeah.
Or a grabfest, I don't know.
Which makes more sense.
Or a grabfest.
But then you do get the good thing of the man. You get the hill manager gets involved.
Yeah, the hill manager gets involved. We didn't have an eye poke gag, which I thought was a Cyclops.
She does dig at it once, but you didn't get a
proper Roddy Piper to the eye, basically.
Which would have been amazing.
Or like the end of Bomb. But we didn't get that, which I thought would have been self-explanatory, but no, we didn't get that at all. There's a Cyclops win, I can't remember, I think he does.
Cyclops wins.
Yeah. Cyclops wins. Sadly, that's Rosemary out of the way.
Yeah.
Though Rosemary does spit her. She even has the goo. the spitting goo.
Oh, yeah.
Which she does spit him. So we know Rosemary's a spitter.
The other, and before with this as well, for some reason, Herb Dean.
Yes, Herb Dean from UFC turns up as
like
a referee.
Why not? There's enough well-known wrestling referees that you can't get. If you get Kevin Nash, you can get Earl Hebner.
Yeah, you can get Earl Hebner for like $500 or something.
But he's just going to sell t-shirts in the car park anyway and make his money back.
Yeah,
But that's what I didn't understand. Fair enough, he's only in it for this first match and dies. Gets his throat slit. So from now on, apparently every match is no DQ.
Yeah. They're kind of light on rules anyway, because you have to die to beat your opponent. So.
Yeah, they never mentioned like it would have been great if you could just one pinfall just in the background. But this is before that became a big deal, and Us English made that. I'm fucking claiming that now. That whole one fall chant thing came, I think, from like IPW shows.
It must have done. But the commentators call a low blow a dirty kick to the dick, which I thought was well fucking played. and then we get laser eye finish. And the first bit opened my head when I saw laser eye finish was Cornette face. Because I can only imagine what Cornette would think of this one, you know. Not being a purist.
Oh, I would love it. I don't know. I feel like he could actually watch this and be alright with it.
It's got Jimmy Hart. It's got some of his friends in it.
Yeah.
But.
I also like the fact that they mentioned that Witch Bitch used to be part of a tag team until her tag team partner got burned at the stake. I mean, that's fucking good. That's a throwaway line. But it's so genius because they have like tail of the tape for each fight.
Yeah.
How many years they've been alive? Yeah. How many fights they've had?
This thing is Camper and Glow. Anyway.
Oh, God, it's so nice.
We also get after the match where the Cyclops, was he using laser eyes on it?
He uses laser eyes. That's the finish. But he does have a Goldberg style comeback as well.
Yeah. He comes out doing the whole Goldberg, fisty kicky. He comes out doing that. So there's obviously a few Goldbergisms there. And then after the match, he kills her. Then the midget decides to come out and wear a chair.
The Cyclops does win the match by celebrating like the Ultimate Warrior of the fucking ring shake as well.
Then the midget gets beheaded.
Oh, it gets like pulled off and punk kicked. Yeah, it's amazing.
So good about this film, it does have a beheaded midget in it.
Yeah.
So
you can't
that's
say
your
that
bad.
For many films.
No, you can't say that for many films, sadly. You know, we didn't see that in Time Bandits.
Yeah.
No. Sadly.
Right, on to match two.
Yeah, match two.
I have from the Metropolitan Museum, New York City, originally from Alexandria, Egypt. I'm only saying that because the box on the front. The mummy, aka King Khafre, which they believe that's what the mummy is, was originally King Khafre. There is they have a news article, like a news bulletin thing, go across the bottom of the screen saying the mummy has escaped from the museum, followed by MILF, mummy I'd like to find. Again, throwaway line in the background of a TV, but fuck me funny.
Yeah. Well, they actually have the policeman on the whole thing say, if you see this man, y'all give me a call now, you hear? So it's like really casual, like it's just...
For New York. Yeah, you would expect that for a small town in Texas somewhere.
You think it's just a cat up a tree or something, you know, or someone's nicked them, put a push bike or whatever.
Yeah.
Just, you know, an Egyptian mummy coming back from the, to kill. seemed a bit understated.
Yeah. And the mummy's opponent from Transylvania is, well, vampire. I don't know if they have a name for a really vampire lady. They have one for that reason. I didn't write that far down. The opening, well, the primary scene for the vampire is that you have an agent. Agent Lawrence is hunting down, and she is the last of her kind. She ends up killing him very fucking easily.
Yeah.
Like, she looks like a vampire, so I don't know how the fuck he ever, like, got confused at this point.
The whole thing is built up like these little vignettes you get in Impact
it is very Impact.
Yeah.
It's very, we're going to use Getty watermark-free images and of, like, skylines and stuff like that, and then cut so it looks obviously well different, so you tell it's just something that's spliced together.
It did. The whole thing felt like a debut of a TNA women's wrestler,
basically. Oh god, yeah.
But sadly not. However, I've got written down my notes here. The minute we see the mummy, I've got written down, it's the Yeti.
Yeti. Sadly does not hump anyone to death. And
Hogan does not get bummed to death, I've got written here as well.
God.
Lot of this stuff feels like the Impact stuff they do with Father James Mitchell. It feels like a whole mad fucked up
film. He could
have
wrote this film amazingly.
Yeah. Again, he seems to be remiss, sadly, in not being in the film.
Oh,
but,
yeah. As a manager, it would have been perfect.
He would have been bang on right about there, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
And the whole thing does feel like the whole TNA thing when they go in the coffin and the Impact thing when they go in the coffin and wind up in Sinister's madnessy fucking glowy filtered world where they kill fucking women with axes and stuff, you know.
Yeah, and then that's the one that isn't that the one that WWE then tried to rip off with the New Day versus the Bright? Was that going back to Broken Hardy?
That's the Broken Hardy, okay. Broken Hardy universe. Now this is the low budget discount.
I haven't seen this one enough.
Oh, it's fucking brilliantly silly.
The match between them, between the mummy and the vampire, half decent. You do get this. I got it wrong. I said it happened in the previous match, but it happened in this match. Mummy throws powder spot. Oh, fantastic! Fucking loved it. You don't get that enough nowadays.
Apparently, the mummy is training 14th century fisticuffs. I don't know what that means, but I can only imagine.
Very old fashioned, like you have to just like rotate your fists around one person's face.
So yeah, we have that match.
I also have here that. Sleeper hold by the mummy, grabs a wooden stake. Mummy uses medallion to blind the vampire. Like it's a spot heavy match.
It is very spot heavy. You know, I can imagine the Young Bucks approving of this.
Oh yeah,
it is a very spot heavy match.
The match is won by Lady Vampire. That's her name, Lady Vampire.
Lady Vampire.
I was close. Wins the match by ripping the blackened heart out of the mummy.
Yes.
Which hasn't turned to sand. And ironically, I don't understand. It's a fucking mummy. I'm sure they take out the heart.
Well,
Find anything from year three.
When they had, when Jim Cornette had Prince Karras the Mummy in Smoky Mountain, or it might have been Memphis, I get confused, they cut his thumb off one time and sand come out.
Oh, yeah. I think it was Memphis.
So, you know, I guess Memphis are more for continuity than this film is, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Jerry Lawler for you, ain't it?
Memphis got it right. Memphis got it
right.
So, I'll ignore that, it's rude.
What did you put?
I've got, they say the word wrath, but I couldn't tell if it was wrath or rape.
Oh God, we can't get into it. No, we're not squeezing. We're not hedge.
We're not squeezing another rape in.
We ain't got time. That one's just for us.
We're so not having that.
No, we can't. I feel like every time we say this, it goes in though.
Like a rape. As ring work goes, the mummy wasn't that bad, which just goes to show WCW really lucked out when they had him in that time, you know.
Wasn't that El Gunte
in the mummy suit? No, Paul Delgado, I think it was that one that was in the flock, that big chap.
Oh, Reese?
Yeah, I think it was him. Because El Gunte
he became a super ninja, didn't he? Whatever it was, afterwards.
Yeah, for about a week, I think. But this film looks like a Dungeon Doom Fest anyway, you know.
Oh, yeah, it does.
Kamala Shark and all the other shit. But
Sullivan, my son.
Sullivan.
I always thought that was Vader.
No, Vader was in there for about.
I know he was, but I thought he was the fucking master, the old bloke in the phone, because he looks like he's just a fat bald bloke.
I always thought it was funny they never had him sort of at least take a bump.
He
was just in the studio, weren't he? But he was still never had him take. Hogan never got his revenge on him, just on the Dungeon Doom.
Yeah.
And
right. Anyway, next match.
Yep.
I have from Silver Springs, New Jersey, Werewolf. Well, I thought it was a werewolf. It turns out it's the hunter whose wife or girlfriend has been killed by a werewolf-like creature, because I don't call it a werewolf. He then gets bitten while trying to get revenge, because he has a weird fucking Rocky version of like a I'm going to get in shape to fight this werewolf scene, which is quite funny. It should have had Eye and the Tiger in the background. It would have been a lot better. He ends up getting bitten by the werewolf, turns into the werewolf, and apparently he's just like, I'm just going to use my powers now to wrestle.
Yeah, he's a lycanthrope who wrestles.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
But, he's a werewolf, and his hair was perfect.
The mane. The mane on him. Amazing.
Yeah,
amazing.
His hair was perfect. Amazing. Swamp Gut is the other guy.
Great promo for Swamp Gut. Again, they went full. To make a full suit that could also go into water in a sense and not look shit.
Yeah.
Actually, we did put the right cover up. Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
Off that.
We're continuity tonight. No, Swamp Gut has the Kamala intro, which in Memphis they had Kamala, who was from the deepest, darkest jungle of Africa. He was running around in his pants in Lawler's back garden.
Yes.
And we have a similar thing here, but in a swamp, basically.
But they film it very much like a David Attenborough Blue Planet. It's like a voice token over the top saying, there's only 10 swamp creatures left now because their habitat has been taken over.
I like this film because it's 100% free in its absurdity.
He doesn't give a shit.
They're going with it. They're going for it, basically.
Yeah.
It's absurd. They know it. They don't care. Fucking hell.
Yeah. I have a Swamp Gut is from Marshfields in Louisiana, shown on the Grizzly Planet, which is their kissing their version of Blue Planet, is what they're calling it.
Yeah.
Shown him wading through the swamp, eating dead things. There's a couple of dead bodies placed around. His main thing is he has a spit that is able to paralyse, and that's how he traps his victims.
He even does the Friday the 13th ending, where he comes out of the water and pulls a chap out of the boat over into the drink.
Very Jason-esque.
Yeah. Swamp Gut has a match with the Wolfman. It's okay. Wolfie can work, but it's not really a work rate film anyway.
No.
He does a big splash, and loads of goo exhales from the...
Yeah, it's the only big bit of it, really. It's just a sort of frog splash off the top rope, just showing that he can, really.
Yeah, this was a bit of a card filler, this one, weren't it?
Proper-sized ring as well, this one. Not an indie-rific ring.
Yeah, not an indie-rific ring. They have a big fuck-off WF one, 20 by 20 by the look of it.
Yeah. Know?
But, we have a big splash. That's Swamp Guts out of the way.
I like the fact that they do have a Punch-Out reference. As well, because they make a point of saying that the Swamp Gut's gut is the same size as King Hippo's. Just like, well done, sir. Tip hat to that one.
Big Nash turns up.
Oh, fucking hell, yes. Amazing acting.
Big Kev turns up. He's a...
corporal.
He's a 7-foot fucking corporal with a ponytail.
Who's hench as fuck.
Who's absolutely ripped.
Wearing a t-shirt too small, but on purpose.
Yeah. Wearing a t-shirt that fucking wouldn't have fit a fucking cruiserweight. Sure doesn't fit Nash. No. He turns up. Now Nash was actually a former Marine, I do believe. Doesn't show here.
Yeah, I don't think he was.
Yeah, something to do with the army, but it really does not show here, basically.
No, they go to what I'm guessing they're classing as a black site.
Yeah.
For fuck's sake.
Okay.
Let's redo that one. I don't know why you're fucking laughing at the word black site. Oh, that's blacked. That's different. Oh, yeah. I'm admitting to what porn I watch now. Fuck it, I did in the previous episode. We're back on it. So Nash and some random other guy goes to a US government black site where they are keeping the zombie, I guess, sort of chained up hostage.
Yeah, as you would,
It's apparently the zombie is a government project which they've been keeping secret to be their new weapon.
Yep, I guess, I don't know. I don't know who they're fighting, I don't stress on that, but either way.
Afghans, always.
Yeah, it's always Afghans.
Remember. Anyone in the Middle East, America will fuck them up.
It's always America's way. But
if they've got a chance to drone a couple of fucking innocent people, they'll do it.
Yeah. But apparently to release a zombie out there is the way forward, they think.
Yeah. He tells his buddy who's with him to unchain to see what kind of fighting shape the zombie is in. And he does, and straight away, zombie just kills the bloke.
Yeah.
And Nash just looks on, just like, yes, yes.
Yeah. Nash was happy if no one else was.
Oh, yeah. Nash done his job.
So I've got written here, Nash Hill turn.
Oh, shock horror.
Yep, shock horror.
Wasn't Nash a finger poker doom.
And then, of course, we get his opponent, the zombie's opponent, which, of course, is Frankenstein.
So on to Germany, where Frankenstein, or, well, to be correct, Frankenstein's monster, which they do make a point of saying... You know it's technically Frankenstein's monster if you want to be a dick about it. Because it's true. It's where everyone who's fucking either read the book or has watched this sort of film goes, actually, it's Frankenstein's monster. Frankenstein's a doctor. Fuck off.
Yeah, that's pretty much that.
Considering they call him Dr. Igora.
Yeah, Dr. Igora.
It's not Dr. Frankenstein.
No. No, they're at least... They at least know what they're doing with that gag. I think that whole thing was set up just to get that little point across.
Yeah, it really is. And it's a throwaway line, which is fucking good. It's what's great about this film.
it's got some good bits. We have that sort of introduces Frankenstein. Of course, Frankenstein is played by Kurgan.
Yes. Good old Kurgan.
Kurgan's one of those guys, isn't he?
Bit of a journeyman.
Yeah, I always thought he looked the bollocks, didn't he, though?
But couldn't fucking move for shit.
No, that the face of him alone looks fucking menacing. This before you dress him up as Frankenstein. But...
Yeah, I think he had appeared in... I don't know if it was 300 or one of those fucking films.
Mm-hmm.
He's also... I think he was like a monster or like kind of some sort of half-dead thing. 300.
He fights Robert Downey Jr. in Sherlock Holmes as well.
In Sherlock Holmes, he's. I think he's like, if you need a tall fucker, he's your man.
Yeah, if you're a tall, medicine-looking brute, he's your
man. And you don't need him to talk, he's your man.
Yeah, well, I always felt he should have had a bit more.
Could have fed him to Undertaker at a throwaway WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Just do a bit of like what you done with like Ryback or Braun Strowman, just make him job out people constantly. But he was always part of like a team or a stable.
Yeah, I
Was he part of like he was part? Was he part of the group?
He's not part of the Truth Commission.
Truth Commission.
Then he was part of the the oddities.
Wasn't he in Undertaker's Ministry of Darkness at one point? I remember him being Black Trunks, but I can't remember if that was part of a thing.
No, I don't remember him in there, but...
It was in another group as well. I can't remember.
Possibly. But he was always a guy I had a soft spot for anyway. But yeah. I don't think anyone else did. He never really got over there.
Never had his own t-shirt.
No, he never had his own shirt, you know. But, yeah, in this, he's pretty good, I think. You know?
Yeah, plays it well. Yeah, he is a fucking monster, so you can play it well.
Nash comes out as a manager for the zombie.
Yeah, it was. It's like it kind of does. It does take away from the zombie a little bit because the zombie's the most boring looking one out of them all.
Yeah, yeah. The zombie has a promo beforehand, but obviously can't talk to the zombie. Nash talks for him and refers to him as a stitch that bastard, which I thought was quite good. The match is by this point the film's kind of starting to wind down basically because you kind of sort of run the gags can be a bit stretched quite thin.
Yeah.
By this stage, so you could have shortened this match.
I think the only reason the film doesn't get boring is the commentating team.
Yeah, yeah, they hold it together quite well. We have a bit there where he, how's it go on this one? What's it, the zombie, Nash takes an axe to Dr. Igora.
Yeah, after the, Dr. Igora does a run-in spot to try and help, then Nash comes in. I have it written down that, oh, fucking hell, I'm surprised he didn't tear a quad doing the over-the-top rope, kind of like get into the ring spot.
Big Nash does a hatchet job on someone I've got written here.
Oh, so. Well done, sir. Well done.
Yep, this, of course, inspires Kurgan.
It's a very classic big-small match.
Yeah.
The same thing happens in the last match as well. It's a very classic big-small match in the fact that you can't. It's really hard to get the Frankenstein off his feet.
Yeah. The death of his manager provokes Frankenstein to
go fucking full. He goes full retard.
He goes full on retard on him.
I don't think it's nah.
Well, fuck it, we're having full on retard.
Okay. Full retard, hulks up, same thing.
Yeah, does a big chokeslam finish. That's the zombie taken out.
I think one of the only wrestling move in this match. You can have a hoss fest in this one.
This was a slower now, folks. But we have that in there. He does a foot stomp for the win. But then there's a twist to this, basically. The zombies awaken. And they all start popping out of graves. Because don't forget, we are in a graveyard.
Yeah.
So they all start popping out of their graves. And they all start eating everybody, basically. Including Big Nash.
They take a couple of bites out of Nash. They take a couple of bite out of one of the commentators.
Yeah.
Who you don't realise, like, that often. Because they line up the commentary with the action quite well in this last match. That one of the commentators is turning to a zombie while he's giving commentary. And if he wasn't from the cutback scenes, you wouldn't notice too much.
Jimmy Hart shits himself with the two girls and runs away.
Yeah. You
know, he's not a fan of zombies.
No.
You know. He's managed to be fucking stiff in his time. Right? But there you go. They may have done. I've got written down my notes. Big Nash won't take a bump, even in death.
Yeah. Again, we have skipped over that. It is the werewolf versus Frankenstein in the final. I don't think it. At first, I didn't really think it was that fair because it's like Frankenstein got no time to recover. But fuck it.
Yeah.
That's not too bad.
No.
That was probably where they had the intermission. They did the raffle shit like that. Yeah. Like you get a normal show.
They went out and sold some t-shirts to that point.
Yeah. Werewolf has changed his shirt while in the promo. Don't know why. Probably got a bit sweaty.
The commentator puts alcohol on the zombie wound and says he's fine.
Yeah.
Which, that's quite that. I've got here, Wolfman does a decent promo.
Yeah, he cuts a decent one.
Yeah, he cuts a half-decent promo. Again, was it RJ Sizzler or RJ Burger? Or whatever?
You know, where the fuck it was.
Whatever his name was. He wasn't too bad in this, actually. This is the big finale, the big main event, the one for the belt, basically. Why have I got a belt for
an undead? Why have I got a belt fucking... which looks like a clay and tinfoil version of John Cena's spinner belt?
I've got written here, looks worse than the WF title at present, which...
I don't know, I quite like it. I don't like the universal belt and the red strap.
That looks like a fucking Jammy Dog jacket.
Yeah, the best belt is still the IC belt.
Yeah, yeah, that at least looks like a championship belt.
Actually saying that, either that or the NXT UK belt.
Yeah, that thing is glorious.
Oh, I want a copy of that.
I have a soft spot for the NXT second tier belt. What's that one called? The US title?
Yes.
Yeah, that's
the one with the big globe. Is it Adam Cole wears it at the moment?
Yeah. But my soft spot, all-time favourite belt for me would be NWA world title with the globe, the old-fashioned one.
I'm a big fan of the Winged Eagle.
That's got some class to it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Apart from that, we said best belt, least favourite belt.
Oh, fuck me, least favourite belt.
Mine would have to be probably like some, like, it kind of groups them all together, but TNA heavyweight titles after the NWA
yes.
era.
Yeah,
because they've got the weird fucking spikes and stuff coming off it. They had like the Jeff Hardy version at one point.
Oh, God, yeah.
Weird purple thing, which they actually kept, which made no sense. But
I'm not a fan, for aesthetic reasons, of the...
I hated the Undisputed belt as well.
Yeah, I think it's fucking ghastly.
Too big. But, only suited Brock Lesnar. It's the only person who suited.
Yeah. I don't like the WF version of ECW's world title.
Oh.
For the simple fact it was silver.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I hate the current tag belts because they're bronze. Because that automatically says these are second tier titles. These are beneath
yeah.
the world title.
If not, you
not
do it how the UFC does and have those bronze belts as like the number one contenders carry
yeah,
those belts
yeah,
out
yeah.
and then you have a gold one for the mains.
Yeah, but it just, it nothing says this belt is not as important as the top one by it not being gold. Basically.
No, Intercontinental belt all the way, definitely the best one. Even the old Intercontinental belt,
yeah.
even it was a stretched out globe, but the fact it was gold and blue,
yeah,
like it looked good on a lot of people. Like when Randy Orton had it, it really suited him.
It's
like
yeah,
that.
Belts are a tricky one because they can even
belts have lost their luster nowadays.
Yeah, Kurgan wins his match.
Yeah,
he wins the world title. He's the big fucking effing deal now. He's the guy in the undead realm of.
In fact, he leaves
whatever.
The European scene to make it to make his debut in North America. I'm like, oh, well done, that's clever.
Yeah.
Like he's a journeyman who travels around from territory to territory.
That's got some. I think you're giving him more credit there than they actually thought. I think that's probably just coincidence.
It was a cutaway line,
yeah.
but I liked it.
Yeah, that was the longest match yet. Was the finale there? As far as tournaments go, it's no King of the Ring 93.
No,
but it's not bad.
It's probably better than the more recent like.
Yeah.
WWE King of the Rings, that are just on
yeah.
the network.
It's going to be better than King Corbin, which we're never going to fucking get because we fucking do. Yeah, we have that, then Big Nash turns up. Nash is now a zombie.
With fuck all makeup on.
With fuck all makeup
on. He's just
on.
Literally got two bites on his arms, and apparently we're supposed to say he's a zombie now.
Yeah.
And then the ultimate cock tease.
Yeah, we have a big cock tease.
They both get go to square off against each other.
Yeah.
Nash is actually fucking taller.
We get the Hogan. We get the Hogan Andre fucking WrestleMania 3 front cover fucking pose off with the faces, and then
both wind up for a punch. They go to hit each other. Credits.
There you go. That's your fucking lot, you know. So instead of getting that match, which I'm sure I'm probably going to put some oil.
Sequel.
Yeah, there you go. Got to get that sequel in, haven't we? You know. But yeah, then we're off to the races with that, and that's your film over with.
Yeah. The only other bit to mention about the end of the film is the fact that one of the commentator that did get bitten as a zombie.
And has now turned and goes for the other commentator.
Yeah, and then because they cut away to a technical difficulty screen, and you just hear one gunshot, and he comes back with a neck collar on. He's like, Sasquatch has sadly died. He leaves behind 9 children, 5 wives.
yeah, and that's your lot basically. You're off to the races then.
Yeah.
However, the twist is like the Marvel movies of now. You know. We then have a little bit after credits.
I fucking skipped the credits. It wasn't on my version.
No,
all right.
Oh, well, you know. Well, Jimmy Hart's talking on the phone to someone, probably Hulk, let's be honest, about the film, and he's basically like, oh my God, it was a great fucking show. Oh God, it was great. We had monsters, we had zombies, we had everything, you know. And the zombies behind him. And
I say, apparently, apparently this is Mickey Mouse now.
Yeah, you know. Well, yeah. But, yeah, then Jimmy Hart sees the zombies like, oh God, I'll call you right back, Hulk. You know, it's probably Hulk.
Yeah, it's probably Hulk.
Yeah. Obviously, get a ring. he then
nasty boys.
The Mountie. But yeah, he puts down the phone. And he's like, "Hey, I was just telling my friend how much I love zombies." Zombie gets him, kills him, pulls him under the ring, and Jimmy's like, "Oh no, I won!"
Oh, should have been Hornswoggle.
Yeah, that's your fucking lot, basically. So you get one little bit. You get one little extra Jimmy Hart bit because Jimmy Hart's awesome.
It's Jimmy Hart. Yeah, he goes full fucking Jimmy Hart for this. Doesn't pull
yeah.
any punches. He goes full
no,
back
no.
in like the 80s, 90s.
Yeah, you didn't get Jimmy Hart to be modern anyway, let's be honest.
No, you never would.
No. So that's that one. Yeah, so that was Monster Balls.
Monster Balls.
Monster Brawl. Monster Brawl. Yeah, okay.
Definitely a solid film. I'll give it 7 out of 10.
Yeah, I'll go 7. Easily a 7. That is a definite...
This is a definite watch with mates and
yeah,
like food and
yeah.
shit like that. It's a fucking
yeah.
class watch.
It's not The Wrestler. Don't watch this with the expectation of seeing a work rate match because you're probably not going to see it.
There's 3 or 4 moves
yeah.
throughout the whole film.
Allow it to revel in its absurdity. That's
yeah, just don't, again, you can't... Well, I don't think anyone would go into this taking it seriously, but just don't.
No, sure.
Well, from me, Ellie Redding.
And for me, it's Stevie Pearson.
This has been another episode of Wrestling at the Movies. See you next time.
See you at ringside.